Now I would like to request our speaker for the evening, Dr. Purush Parikh, to carry on.
Please.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Please go to the next slide. Go back one slide. Okay, so I don't have a disclaimer slide today, but I will tell you that this is meant as a continuing medical education. It is primarily for allopathic doctors. And why I say allopathic doctors is because it is based on the telemedicine practice guidelines that was published by the Board of Governors of Medical Council of India, which is applicable only to allopathic doctors. So if there's somebody who's not an allopathic doctor who's logged in, I would request you to please log off because these guidelines are not for you. We will have a lot of discussions, and even after the question answers are over, if you still have some doubt, then please consult a medical legal expert to clarify your doubt. Next slide, please. So these guidelines were published on 25th March 2020, just over a month ago. And after that, there have been three other modifications, so to speak, that have come out. One is that while we are talking about allopathic doctors, Ayush also brought out a similar guideline. Then there was clarification on medicines by Board of Governors MCI on 6th April, and a FAQ came out on 11th April. So things are dynamic, and we should keep a watch on what the regulations are as it moves forward. Next slide. So many people ask me the question, can I start doing teleconsultation today? Then the answer is clearly yes. The next question is this permission indefinite? And the answer is no. Now, why do I say that? The guidelines were originally to come out in the year 2022. That is 2 years from now. Unfortunately, because of the problems of COVID, the government had to quickly bring out these guidelines. And therefore, they did not have the opportunity and the time to set up a training and certification program. So they have given a 3-year window to us, and by 24th March in the year 2023, we should be certified or we cannot use it. Therefore, the permission is not indefinite and we have to get a certification sometime or the other. Next. So now you might ask the question, I'm at home, I'm free. Next slide, please. Can I do the certification now? And the answer is yes, we are able to offer this to you. And all those who attend this training program or those who have attended earlier will be given a link at the end of the program where you can attempt the questions. There are 50 questions, and if you get 35 right, then obviously you will pass and we'll give you a certificate. If you get less than 35, you will still get your marks and also the right answers. So you can attempt the exam a second time to make sure that you are clear with it. Next, please. These telemedicine guidelines refer to an interaction between the doctor, that is us, on one side, and at the other side, there could be one of four people, either the patient himself or herself, a caregiver of the patient, a health worker like a nurse or a A&M, and it could also be another doctor at the other side. So please understand that telemedicine guidelines allow us to do this interaction not only with the patient, who is the primary objective, but also with his caregiver, with a health worker, and with another doctor. Next slide. Now, how to select the mode of communication is very important. And here I have taken a few examples only. The guidelines allow us to use any mode of communication, including social media. So let us see what are the advantages and disadvantages of some of them. So if there's a video, it is good because patient identification becomes easy and a visual inspection examination is possible. The downside is that the opposite party might be recording everything that has been happening, and therefore we have to be careful about what we say and show. Also, if somebody else is walking in the room, then there is a breach of confidentiality, and we have to caution our staff at our end as well as the patient about relatives in his home. As far as the audio teleconsultation is concerned, this is too convenient for the patient point of view. They can call us at any time of the day or night and insist on asking for some replies. And therefore, we have to be careful what number, what phone number we share with our patient. Also, because we can't see the person at the opposite end, we have to be aware of imposters. And this is particularly true because nowadays there are many such frauds happening where they are trying to take away some finances from us. Another thing that we have to worry about on in terms of imposters is a quack at the other side. And a quack is telling us details about his patient, pretending to be that patient. And then based on our guidance, he will treat that patient. So that is something we have to be careful about. Social media is all over the place and it is really advantageous because unless an individual signs in and provides his details, he cannot use social media. For instance, WhatsApp or Google will have the patient's person's display picture as well as he has to use a password and phone number. So identifying the patient is easy. Identity is easy, but it is susceptible to hacking. And we should also beware of the famous blue tick on WhatsApp because it conveys to the patient party that we have read the message. And then if we don't reply, then they get very upset and angry. As far as I'm concerned, email is the best. And the reason is that it automatically archives on the cloud. So I don't have to worry about archiving. And the opposite party does not expect me to reply immediately. So there is a lag period and I can do it at my convenience. So these are some of the strengths and limitations of various tools of communication that we have. Next. Now, what about insufficient information? Last month, a friend of mine who's a dentist in Srinagar sent me this message on WhatsApp. It was about his brother and he was saying that FNACE was from the liver lesion. Then he said it is from the pelvic region. Then he said it's from the axilla. So I was totally confused as to what was going on here. Then finally, he sent me this image, which I'm showing you. And that was on a plain paper, which was not a letterhead or something. It was handwritten. And it started by saying a CT-guided and ultrasound-guided biopsy. Now, I don't remember ever so far in my life seeing a patient getting a CT-guided and ultrasound-guided biopsy at the same time. So I was very concerned as to what was happening. And then finally, there was a scrawl as a signature without a name or a stamp. So I told him that, see, I can't help you right now. When you get a proper report, please send it to me and we will continue. So whenever there is insufficient information, this is how we have to address the problem. Next. So when there is insufficient information, be it in terms of history or examination or investigation reports, we have the authority to ask for additional tests or additional information. So we might ask for a blood test or a biopsy or a CT scan. And in such instances, the teleconsultation is deemed to have been paused. Now, please understand, pausing the teleconsultation is possible only by the doctor. Okay. And then it has to be resumed at a time that is convenient to us. So we will reschedule the time for the continuation of the teleconsultation. And this is very good for us. Next. Now, what about when prescription has to be given? So in an emergency, no prescription is allowed. Okay. In an emergency, we have to only advise first aid and ask the patient to go to the nearest possible doctor or hospital. So for instance, if somebody has injured his thigh with a knife at home, I can advise him how to tie a tourniquet and then go to the doctor. Prescriptions are allowed only in the non-emergency situation. And whether we can prescribe, what drugs we can prescribe in first consultation or follow-up consultation is dependent on the different lists that is provided in the guidelines. Next. So there are four lists in the guidelines, list O, A, B, and restricted. And these are not the same as the schedule of drugs in the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. So please be careful. These are lists and schedule is what CDSCO and DGCI has put up. Now list O is over-the-counter medicine. So we can use and prescribe the over-the-counter medicine at any time, no problem, even at the first consultation. If we have to prescribe from list A, which is medicines for diabetes or hypertension or antibiotics, then the first consultation has to be a video consultation. If somebody calls me on the landline or if somebody calls me on the phone on audio and I have to prescribe medicine from list A, I am not allowed to do that. It has to be converted from audio to video call, and I can even use a WhatsApp call to convert that way. If the patient is already on a medicine from list A, and then because his blood pressure is not controlled, in addition to Stamlo, I want to add a diuretic, that is from list B, and that can be done at a follow-up consultation, whether it is audio or video, both are allowed. The restricted medicines are particularly those which are narcotic and psychotropic, but not all Schedule X medicines are restricted. There are some which are restricted, some which are not. And on 11th April, the updated list of medicines was brought out by the Board of Governors. And I would refer you to that in case you want to look at that. So particularly for patients who are under psychiatric treatment, this restricted list is very important. And at the end of the session, we will share with you a link where all these documents are available on our website and you can easily access and download them from the website. Next, please. Now, why is it that we should focus on telemedicine? Because the market is really huge. And this is a small back of the envelope sort of calculation that says that if I have to cater and provide my services to rural India, there are 20.8 million such virtual consultations that can happen in our country every year. Next slide. Now, this is an example of how we can take advantage of social media to popularize and tell everybody that we are offering telemedicine consultation. So this is being used on Facebook, and that is the point number one that I mentioned. Dr. Suresh Advani is a very senior most medical oncologist and has been my teacher. If you look at the date, this was posted by Sir on 23rd March. That is 2 days before the telemedicine guidelines came out by the government. Point number three is that we have to display our name, our degrees, and our designation as per approval of Medical Council of India. So the degrees and designation should be only those which are allowed by Medical Council of India. And the fourth one is the power of the social media. You can see that within a few hours of his posting this video, 1,500 people have shared his video. So please understand that we must optimize our online presence to make sure that we can do our best for the people who are not able to reach us. Next slide. Now, why is there resistance from patients? In one of the WhatsApp groups, which has more than 250 members, you can see that I have highlighted some of the WhatsApp display statements. And out of these 250 odd oncologists, there were only three who said no emergency messages or no WhatsApp or phone consultation or no WhatsApp consultation. What this tells us is that we have been spoiling our patients by allowing them to contact us anytime without any charge and disturbing us and insisting on treatment. So this resistance from patients will continue, and we have to be very firm, and we have to use this telemedicine practice guidelines from the government to say that now we have to comply with what the government has said. We have to keep a record of every telemedicine consultation or advice I'm giving you, and therefore it has to follow the due process for me to document and of course to charge the fees. Next. Now, how do we receive the fees? Now, this is just one example of how I have compared three different payment gateways or wallets, PhonePe, Paytm, and Google Pay, which are the most common ones. Now, we have to be careful how we select the right one here because it's going to cost us money. For instance, in Paytm, for every app used, they charge 1.75% plus GST. In addition, if I have to transfer the money from Paytm to my bank account, they will charge 4% extra. So this comes to almost 6.5% gone to Paytm. PhonePe is a little better, but if I am transferring more than 5,000 rupees from the app to the bank account, they will start charging. So among these three, the best is Google Pay, which has no charge, and it is the highest security among the three. So this is how we have to compare and then decide what mobile wallet we want to use. Next. But this is the mobile wallet that I would recommend to people, doctors, who have a large number of patients coming from the rural area. And the reason for this is State Bank mobile cash, mobile wallet does not require a smartphone. Even from a feature phone, simply by sending an MPIN or a 6-digit code by SMS, money will be transmitted and you will receive it. So again, I'm saying that any doctor who has a large number of rural patients should use this, and this is very inexpensive. Right now, there's only a one-time charge of rupees 20 plus tax for the KYC documentation. That's all. And therefore, I think this is a good recommendation. Next. But we have to look at patients' convenience, and if we can offer a bouquet of payment options, it is better for patients, and therefore, good chance that we will have more patients. So net banking, debit card, credit card, mobile wallet, Google Pay, Paytm, etc., etc. More we offer, the better it is for us. Next. There are also lots of telemedicine consultation apps that are available. There are 32,000 apps globally. There are more than 100 apps in India, and some of them are free and open source. So you have a large option to pick whatever is most convenient to you. Next slide. But what I use is simple email. For my telemedicine consultations, I have a separate email called drpurveshtelemedicine@gmail.com. The reason is that this automatically archives all the documents, all the messages, all the consultation, all the prescriptions on the cloud, and only I have access to this. This is encrypted and there is no charge for it. I also use the subject line to customize coding so that I can retrieve it easily in case I am required to use it or retrieve it in the future. It also provides an automatic date and stamp, so that is also not a problem. Next. This is the code that I use in the subject line so that I know what is the serial number. That is the first three numbers. The next three are the initials of the patient. The next three numbers are the serial numbers for that particular patient. FU stands for follow-up. If it is first consultation, it will be FC. And then the next two places are for a variety of codes which I have highlighted here. For instance, AU is audio, VI is video, and so on and so forth. And finally, there is a date on which I have done. So this allows me to archive systematically for free on the cloud without me having to pay a single paisa for this. Next slide. And this is how, if I have to retrieve the emails, I can find them on my email address. Number one attachment is terms of consultation, which I always send to the patient before I give them an appointment. Number two represent a prescription that I've sent to the patient. And number three is archiving of a WhatsApp image that was received by me from the patient. So whether the patient sends it or I'm sending it, both can be archived very easily. And even if the patient has sent me by some other means like WhatsApp, I can email that to myself and therefore archive it conveniently. Next slide. Now, how to document a consent? In many instances, the consent is implied in the telemedicine consultation. But supposing you want to document a consent, then I would recommend that you look at this website called takemycare.in. Okay. This is a remote patient consultation consent. So takemycare.in. When you go there, it actually takes us to a website URL that says dataonweb.com. So I was curious to know what is data on web. Next slide. And I saw that this is a hosting area, which is Apache HTTP server using Senti operating system. And this is quite normal. So this was a genuine website. Next slide. So I looked at the website and what it is showing us. And this is the process of flow for me to obtain a consent. Next slide. So this consent is available today in three languages, English, Hindi, and Marathi. It is also available in Bengali, four languages, and two more, Telugu and Gujarati, are under process. Next slide. So as a doctor, I have to first register my information on this website. Next slide. And this is the additional information about my address that I put. Once I do these two things, next, it provides me a URL that I have to then send to the patient. Okay. And once this I can send by SMS, I can send by WhatsApp, I can send by email. Next slide. When the patient gets this URL, what he has to do is to use this URL on the web. Next slide. And then put in his own details. So this also includes a government issued photo ID. So we can be sure that the patient's identification is properly documented. Next slide. Yes, so then go through this consent document, which is there. And I again, this document is available from their website. So you can easily access it publicly. Right now it is totally free. Next slide. And after reading the document, at the bottom, the patient has to click I agree and then click I give consent. Next slide. When that happens, he gets a URL, which then he has to send to me. Okay. So this is how this process happens online on the cloud. Next slide. And this, when he sends to me, I can access the consent, which is supposed to be in the PDF form. Next slide. Unfortunately, I am yet to receive the PDF, even though it is 48 hours through this process. So I don't know what the glitch is. I will send an email or I will phone these people to find out exactly what the problem is. But right now I'm trying to solve this out. So in the meantime, while I'm trying to solve this, what do I do? Next slide. I have developed my own consent, which is available on our website. You can download and modify it as you require. Next slide. And it has 25 elements. Okay. Besides the preamble, it's 25 elements and I will walk you through some of them. So the preamble is to say why this consent is there, what the government has notified, and who is a doctor, as a registered medical practitioner who is registered with the state medical register or the national medical register. That means an allopathic doctor. Next slide. It starts with the identity and the location of the patient. So he has to give his name, age, sex, and that he is consulting with me. So he has to specify my name as well. He has also to put his address, and this is important because these telemedicine guidelines are valid only if the patient party is within India and I am also within India. So I have to document that this is within the international boundaries of India. So this is for identity and location. Next. Then it is communication. I understand that for the telemedicine consultation, I have made the request. Why do I say that patient has made the request? Because in such instances, the consent is implied. I will also ask him to abide by the appointment given to him, what mode of communication he should use, and follow all the terms and procedures. And I showed you how I send my terms of consultation. Next slide. Providing complete information is vital because we are not able to do a complete examination. And I also ensure that in the consent form, what complete information I require is enumerated. And you can see that here at least there are 8 items which he has to send to me, either just before the consultation or well in advance. Next. What if information is not provided? So I say that doctor will make a judgment on the basis of incomplete information, in which case there will be a wrong diagnosis, wrong treatment. There could be adverse drug reaction or allergies, and patient will be responsible for all consequences of providing incomplete or wrong information. This is part of the consent process. Next. Security. I also specify that anything on the net, anything is on the wide web, is possible that a third party may hack it. So there could be breach of security. Both me and the patient has to be careful about taking security precautions. And if something like this happens because of third party breach, then he cannot hold me responsible. Next. I also specify in the consent the use and limitation of telemedicine consultation. And the limitation are because we can only do a virtual examination on video, and we might have to give access to our staff and their involvement in the whole process. Next slide. Again, I'm coming back to insufficient information, and I'm specifying that the patient knows in the consent that there could be ways in which the information is insufficient because of poor quality of voice, or poor resolution of images, or deviation in color of images because of lighting, or poor connectivity interruptions and call drops. So he should not blame me if something like this happens. Next, please. In addition, I may not be able to understand what the patient may not be able to understand what I am requesting, or I as a doctor may not be able to understand what is the information that is providing. And sometimes this is a language barrier because English may not be the first language for a patient. So I make sure that in the consent he accepts that there are inherent limitations in the telemedicine consultation as compared to in-person consultation. Next, please. About history, accuracy and completeness is important, and that becomes a patient's responsibility. That is also documented in the consent process. Next. What if history is incomplete? If the history is incomplete and patient has forgotten to give me that history, then the consent specifies that it is his responsibility to give me the updated information as soon as possible. For this, he has to request for another telemedicine appointment. And if he does not do that, then all the consequences are the patient's responsibility. Next slide. As far as examination is concerned, I say that the consent process document says that in a non-video consultation, no examination is possible. In a video consultation, only inspection is possible. Palpation and auscultation will not be possible as of now. And the patient has accepted these limitations and its risks. Next. Patient is also advised to request for an in-person visit as soon as possible. And patient responsibility is to make all necessary arrangements to come for an in-person consultation. So this is also part of the consent process. Next. As far as investigations are concerned, it is our prerogative, doctor's prerogative, to ask for any investigations. When we advise such investigation, the patient consents to do them as promptly as possible. And patient is the sole person responsible if they are not done in a timely manner or if they are done but not reported to us. Next. As far as the diagnosis is concerned, I always write a provisional diagnosis. I don't write a final diagnosis on a telemedicine consultation. The final diagnosis is always on an in-person consultation. And the consent document specifies that this diagnosis is dependent on completeness and accuracy of the information provided, cannot replace an in-person consultation, has significant limitations, and accordingly, patient will not hold me liable for any consequences of the same. Next. As far as the advice is concerned, the doctor has agreed to give his advice remotely at the request of the patient. He specifies that the doctor is doing this in good faith, and it is the patient's responsibility to follow the same accurately and consistently. It is also the patient's responsibility to seek an in-person consultation as soon as possible. This is repeated 3 or 4 times in the consent, so he cannot say that I did not see this or I overlooked it. Next slide. Postponement, pause, and termination of telemedicine consultation. Postponement and pause is in our hands. Termination could be either from our side or the patient's side. So both are possible. But as far as the pause and restart is, it is based on what we have to do. So the consent form says that in case of an emergency, I might not be able to come for the scheduled appointment at that time online, and I might need to postpone it. And I will schedule it based on what I am able to do. So it is the sole prerogative of the doctor to decide if it needs to be postponed or rescheduled. And this could be also based on additional information that I require. And this is also part of the consent document. Next. As far as the prescription is concerned, the consent process says that the doctor has prescribed the drugs, but patient has to follow the following. It should be used only for that specific patient and not for anybody else. The patient has to follow all the specifications mentioned in it, the dose, the duration, the time, and the frequency. If the patient does not have benefit or response, patient must seek a fresh appointment, which could be telemedicine or in person. If there are side effects or reaction, it is the patient's responsibility to stop the medicines and seek emergency medical aid. And I also specify that the prescription should not be refilled unless specifically permitted by me. This is because there have been instances where the patient has been taking a medicine for 2 years, 3 years, when it was only prescribed for 2 months. And when he went to court, the Doga, the judges found the doctors negligent because they had not specified how long the medicine has to be taken. Next, please. As far as the medical records are concerned, we will keep them, audio, video, images, documentation, everything. And this is required by the law, so that it becomes part of the consent that the patient is agreeing to this. Next. As far as confidentiality is concerned, both parties are responsible. And the consent says that the patient will not put on social media or public domain anything without the explicit written consent from the doctor. And he should also not share the telemedicine consultation document with anybody else, including friends and relatives. This is again to prevent certain things, which I will go through in detail a little later. Next. So patient misuse of telemedicine process is a crime which is specifically mentioned in the consent. And the reputation of the doctor may be damaged irreparably. So the patient has to indemnify us for this. And he should not use any of these documents to defame or tarnish our image. So that is part of the consent process. Next. I am also asking him to give permission for me to share the documents and the details with other healthcare professionals. So if I want a second opinion from a senior doctor or my colleague, I can use them. And I can also use them for educational activities and in scientific and technical publications. So while I'm having this webinar with you guys, I might be able to show some details of a patient that could be relevant to what we are discussing. Next. Jurisdiction is exceedingly important. Under the current Consumer Protection Act modification, the patient is coming from, say, let's say that the patient is coming from Jaisalmer and the doctor is in Christian Medical College, Vellore. Today, the patient in Jaisalmer can file a case in the Jaisalmer Consumer Court, and the doctor will have to go from Vellore to Jaisalmer every time there's a hearing. So in the consent document, I have specified that the patient must agree that if there's any grievance, the legal and judicial remedy will be in the jurisdiction where the doctor is, so that he has to come to us. We don't have to go to him. Next. Release. It also says that I completely and irrevocably release the doctor, healthcare facility, and all staff from all errors. So that error is not counted as negligence. Error is error, negligence is something different. And therefore, the doctor is not liable or responsible for accurate and completeness of medical information because that is provided by the patient. So this is like a legal release for us. Next. Whether the patient has the ability to actually give the consent or take part in the process of telemedicine should also be documented. So he is giving the consent willingly. He is in his full senses. He is doing this without any pressure or force. He is of sound mind and judgment. He is not intoxicated. And the consent he is providing is of his own free will be properly documented. Next. Now comes to the fees. Every time we do a telemedicine consultation, it is our duty to declare or disclose the fees right at the beginning. So I say that my fees are rupees so and so per appointment of up to 15 minutes. Now this time is exceedingly important because otherwise the patient feels that now that he has paid me 100 rupees or 1000 rupees, he can keep on talking unnecessarily and asking frivolous questions or wasting time. So therefore, I always say that there is a time limit to the consultation. The consent also says that he undertakes to make the payment. If he defaults on the payment, it is proof of his deliberate intent to defraud me. Also, I specify that there is no guarantee in the telemedicine consent. Failure of intended benefit or occurrence of side effects cannot be predicted and are act of God. And if there is a consultation that goes beyond the specific time, or if he requires a follow-up consultation, additional payments are there. Also, the consent specifies that there is no refund of fees. So in this way, the consideration of fees are taken care of. Next. As far as the discussion is concerned, the consent also says that it is of the responsibility of the patient to ask all the queries, doubts, and questions. He should do that within the duration of the telemedicine appointment slot. using the necessary technology and equipment at his end, and at the end of telemedicine consultation, it will be presumed that all his queries have been resolved. This is also part of the consent process. Next. It also says again, what are the limitations of telemedicine consultation? And again, there are no warranties or guarantees for medical condition, diagnosis, outcome, and benefit of recommended treatment. Next. Finally, he signs it and he puts his signature, name, also details of a government issued photo ID, date and place. So this completes the consent process. Next. And this is an example of the prescription that I generate. And at the next webinar that I'm going to do, I'm going to show specifically how such a consent can be generated using your smartphone without having to print out something or without having to go to your laptop or desktop. And this is something that is easily possible. It is also free. All these resources are available online. Next. Now, this is an example of a prescription that was generated by some other doctor on Practo. And here I have highlighted one very important thing. It was the places where it is marked in red, it is to cover the name and the details of the doctor, as well as the name and the details of the patient. What I have highlighted is the provisional diagnosis. In this instance, the doctor has written provisional diagnosis as shoulder and neck pain. I'm sure all of you will agree that this is history. This is an indication of what he is suffering from in terms of complaints. It is not a diagnosis. So on this complaint or history, I cannot prescribe anything. For me to prescribe the complaint, the provisional diagnosis should be either cervical spondylosis or it could be muscle spasm. But I cannot write shoulder and neck pain. After that, it has the medicine is written, how many tablets are to be taken is written, how many times it is written, and it is written daily for after food for 6 days. So that is the perfect part of it. And below that, of course, you must have a full signature, your name, your registration number of the medical council, as well as a rubber stamp. Next. This is another example of some app that provides automatic population of a consent that is there. When you do use this, please understand that whether you're using your own computer or you're using an automatic app, the prescription must be converted into a PDF before you send it to the patient. Why am I saying that? Because if the consent is in a Word document, the other party can manipulate it, can change something, and then say that the doctor was giving me wrong information, wrong advice, or wrong prescription. So please never send anything without first converting it into a PDF. Next. Now, when we are doing a telemedicine consultation, like I'm doing here, I'm actually sitting in my house on my dining table, and this is what you would see if you are in front of me. There are a lot of papers, there is a glass of water, there's a jug of water. But what you are actually seeing behind me is a virtual backdrop. So it is possible to convert the appearance on a Zoom platform in such a way that we can display for the patient and the opposite party professionalism of how we are doing a video consultation. And instead of stethoscope, these are the two features that I'm using. One is what is on my head, that is a good quality headphone and a microphone. And the other is a snake light. And this snake light is essentially to make sure that the lighting on my face is symmetrical. Sometimes the ceiling light is in such a way that it is casting shadows on my face, and then the patient or the opposite party cannot see me clearly. And therefore, I use this very frequently for my telemedicine consultations. Next slide, please. Are the slides over or? I cannot see my slides.
Sir, just give me 1 minute. Gallery view. Okay. Sir, just give me a minute. Sir.
Sure. So basically, the document says that an in-person consultation and telemedicine consultation should be of the same quality. And all over the world, a telemedicine consultation is valued as well as an in-person consultation. So we should not demean or lower our value, and we should make sure that we charge sufficiently and to the same amount as a in-person consultation for each and every telemedicine consultation. I normally take the consultation fees ahead before I give them an appointment, because once the appointment is over, once the advice is given, once we have had the discussion, and once I've sent the prescription, no patient will be happy to send the fees. They will always find some reason or the other not to send the fees. So please understand, what I do is, unless the payment is received by me in advance, I do not give them an appointment. And it is my staff who deal with that till such time as the payment is done. Only then I come into the picture. So I think this is something that we have to teach and train our patients, because for a long time they have been used to getting free advice from us, disturbing us at any time of the day or night, and demanding that we provide them instant answers. They don't even want to wait. At 10 p.m. on Saturday night, they will call and say something about the other. So I think my slides are back, and we will have to keep advancing the slides till we come to the right place. I apologize for this technical hitch. Sometimes the connectivity is an issue and that's it. So this is an example of how I do a video consultation. Okay. The first thing is that you see on the top, recording is ongoing. So everything that I do is recorded and stored on the cloud. The second thing that you see is there is no display picture for my staff who is helping set up the process and making sure that the patient is there at the other end. The third thing that you see is my image or my presence in front of a very pleasing backdrop. And it also gives my email for telemedicine consultation, and that it says, welcome to Dr. Purvesh Parekh video clinic. Okay. So this gives a sort of professional appearance or professional impression to the opposite party. This consultation was at 10 o'clock in the morning. So you can see from the time, which is number 3, that I was ready and online 5 minutes before the consultation started. On the other half of the screen, you will see that I have opened the questions that the patient has asked me. So for every patient, I say that whatever questions you have, please send me by email before the consultation starts, so I can answer each and every question. Sometimes in the emotion during the consultation, they might forget to ask a question. So in this manner, it is easy for them to make sure that they ask me all the questions that are necessary. Next. In spite of giving them all the processes of what to do, we will always find that there are some glitches or at that side. Now, in this particular instance, you can see that the patient is an old lady. Next to the patient is sitting a relative. And in this instance, it was her son. And in addition to me, there is another third person also who is joined. And this third person is a relative of the patient. So I'm saying namaste and saying welcome. But at the same time, the first thing I have to do after telling them my name and my qualification is the patient giving the consent? And the patient says yes. Then I ask, are you also giving consent for your son to be next to you and your relative who has logged in remotely to be part of the telemedicine consult? So the consent confirmation is documented on video because the patient says yes. Next. Then this is the difficulties at one end. Now the person who is next to me on the top, the patient's relative, was an IT person. He is used to video conferences and webinars. So his position and his ability and his ease by which he was working on the teleconsultation was very nice. But if you can see on point number 1, I have shown that the patient's son is moving his hand in front of the screen. In point number 2, he is not able to connect by audio and he is trying to find his phone, and his relative at the other end is actually using the phone to call him and explain to him how to unmute himself and go on and so forth. In point number 3, you see that the son's wife walks into the screen. So this is breach of confidentiality at the side of the on the side of the patient. And in point number 4, again, the patient's husband comes into the picture. So these are common things that we have on the video consultation. We should not get flustered. We have to keep our cool. We have to keep our peace of mind and patiently guide them on how to do the whole process. Next. At the end of the consultation, I always ask, Have I answered all your questions? Are you satisfied with what I've said? And then I say thank you very much in the using the namaste gesture. And here you can see that the patient's son and the patient's relative are reciprocating. So they have confirmed that I have answered all the questions and are satisfied with the virtual consultation. Next slide. Immediately, I then send them an email saying, did I answer all your questions? Are you satisfied with my consultation? And your reply will be most appreciated. And in most instances, next, the reply comes instantly and it is always positive. If you ask for their feedback immediately after the consultation is over, they are exceedingly happy, they are satisfied, and they will give you a positive feedback. I document this so that 3 years afterwards, if the one of the relatives of the patient goes to court and says, no, my patient was not looked after well, or there was a problem in the teleconsultation, I have documentation that they were satisfied with my consultation. Next. Nowadays, of course, there are several home healthcare service providers, especially in the COVID pandemic. You can see that nurses are available at home, some health workers are available at home. They can even make an ICU at home. So our value in providing video consultation or teleconsultation is even more. Any case, we have extra time. We are not able to earn our money by going to our clinics. So this is a great opportunity for us to utilize the time to get familiar with how a telemedicine consultation can happen and how it can give us the satisfaction of helping patients who can't reach us as well as earn money for ourselves. Next. So with this, I end my formal presentation. I thank you all for a patient hearing. Some of you might have questions. You can send it by chat to Rahul Panikkar. He will collate all the questions and forward it to the meeting host. And one by one, the meeting host will call out your name, unmute you, and then you can directly ask the question to me. And I will do my best to try and answer them to the best possible way. At the end of all this, they will also share a link with you by which you will be eligible to take the assessment test. And this has 50 questions. If you get 35 or more correct, then you will get a certificate. If you don't get the correct answers, you will still get a reply saying which of your answers were right, which were wrong, and in those wrong answers, which is the correct answer. So it will help you to take the test again and obtain the certification. So with that, I will stop my discussion as a presentation, formal presentation, and hand it over back to the host for processing the next part.
Thank you, Dr. Parikh, for the wonderful presentation. We will now have the question and answer session. Can I request Dr. J.B. Sharma to ask his question? Sir, I'm unmuting your mic. Please go ahead, sir. Dr. Sharma, can you hear me? So, sir, I'll just read out your question.
Yes.
If the patient is registered in our hospital and I know the patient and he is a follow-up case, still we need identity documents of the patient during teleconsultation?
So this is a very important question and the answer is yes. I will share the story of a dear friend of mine who is practicing in Pune, and a patient who was receiving chemotherapy under his care went to the courts, not the patient, but the patient's relative went to the court after the demise of the patient. And they alleged that the treatment was provided, given to the patient without the consent. The doctor produced the consent in the court. And then the opposite lawyer asked him, it's all right that you produced this document in court, the consent is there, but how do you know that the person giving the consent and the person to whom you have given the chemotherapy is the same person? So at every time when we see the patient, we have to document how we have confirmed the patient identity. This is true not only for teleconsultation, but it is also true for an in-person consultation. And that is why whenever we give a certificate or we write a prescription, in addition to patient name, age, and sex, we are supposed to put some visible mark, visible identity mark for the patient. So this is also true for telemedicine consultation. And even if you know the patient, even if you have seen him 2 days ago in your clinic, when he phones you or when he's on video, we have to reconfirm the identity of the patient. We may not ask for a document again, but I normally ask is, during the first consultation, what is the document that you provided to me to confirm your identity? And he will say Aadhaar card or driving license. So I know that this is the same person. And I write it down that I have confirmed the identity of the patient. I hope that answers JB Sharma's question.
Thank you, sir. Can I request Dr. Alan Pereira to ask his question? Sir, I'm unmuting your mic. Please go ahead. Dr. Alan, you'll have to unmute your mic.
Hello.
Hi, Alan.
Hello.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, yes, sir. Sir, I'd like to know for how long are we supposed to maintain the records of the video chats, the verbal chats, and the other telemedicine details?
So, excellent question. And this is as in the same terms of what we have to preserve for OPD records. So, I would suggest that you keep them for 3 years before you dispose them off. And in case you feel that a patient has not done well, or the patient's relatives were difficult, or that they might go to court, then such records you should keep for even a longer time. But otherwise, without any worry, you can keep them for 3 years and then dispose them off.
Okay. Okay. Yeah.
Dr. Satish Bhatt is here. He is a medical legal expert. If Dr. Satish Bhatt can hear me, we can unmute him and take his comments on the consent process. Satish, are you able to hear me? I think he is not able to hear me. Let's go on to the next question.
Can I request Dr. Ankita Sen to ask a question? Ma'am, I've unmuted your mic. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Excellent presentation as usual. I just, you've already answered my question. I just wanted to know where we can download the Schedule H drugs and the consent form which you mentioned in the seminar. So you just said that it could probably be provided later on.
So at the end of the this webinar, a link will be put up on the chat. You can copy that link. It will take you to the website of Kavina Creations. There will be an icon, clickable icon for telemedicine. When you click on that, you will have access to several documents. There are 2 books that we are providing to you. You can download the chapters and use them as you like. There is all the Government of India guidelines and documents that have come. They are also online. The consent document which I have talked about today is also there. And there will be the link to take the questions and answer them. And if you are successful, then we will provide you the certificate as well. So okay. Everything that you will need will be there. There are also, YouTube videos of what webinars we have done in the past on the same topic. They are also easily accessible. And therefore, if you have to brush up or you have to refresh your memory about a specific thing that we have discussed, you can go back to that YouTube video at any time at your convenience.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you so much, sir. I believe Dr. Rajiv Vijay Kumar has raised his hand. Sir, I've unmuted your mic. Please go ahead, sir.
Good evening, sir. Thank you so much for this fantastic talk, as always.
Thank you.
Sir, the platform that you mentioned that you're doing it, do we have one common platform? Can we make one common platform for so that all of us medical oncologists and any other physician who want to use it? I'm sure you'll be having communications with so many other software companies. So we can use it, it will have everything on it, pay right from a payment gateway to everything.
So that is a very good question. And I'm actually right now in talks with a friend of mine with whom I work for the last 15 years. He's a software engineer. He has his own company. The app that he has is called Easy Clinic. Okay. And that Easy Clinic is able to provide all the things that you have asked for. So right now I'm just discussing with me how we can use that facility as a group and whether we can get some discount or concession on that. And sir, we can take this offline and discuss this further as to what your interests are.
Fantastic, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Can I request Dr. Sajal Goyal to ask his question? Sir, I've unmuted your mic. Please go ahead, sir.
Actually, I've lost the meeting, sir. So my only question is how to keep the records of the teleconsultation.
So anything that is, whether it's an audio file or a video file or a WhatsApp image or a prescription that you have sent by email, all of them you can email to yourself, right? If there's an audio file, you put it as an attachment and email to yourself. If there's a video file, you can put it as an attachment and email to yourself. Or if it is a very, very large file, then you can use, one of the WeTransfer or something to send it to yourself. The best is not to put it on your computer or in your house or in your office, because you never know when it is going to be, when it'll crash or when a virus will disrupt all of them. So I suggest and I use that everything is on the cloud in my email, which is drpurvishtelemedicine@gmail.com. And it is coded in such a way that if I have to access any one particular patient's document, then I can track them based on the subject line. So I would suggest to you that you should also develop a separate email address, which you will use exclusively for your telemedicine consultations only. So it doesn't clutter up your inbox for other things that you are doing regularly with your family and friends. And it is safe. It is accessible only to you. And whenever you want to access those documents or whether when you have to provide them in court of law, then it is easily downloadable and it is done in a manner which is acceptable by the courts. So they will have no problem in accepting the documents that you provide to them.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. We have another question. I'm not sure who's asked the question. What is the difference between advice, opinion, and prescription? And which is the safest one in the long run?
So advice, opinion, and prescription, I can divide them into two. Advice and opinion is on one side. Prescription is on the other side. If I tell on a landline, you take tablet paracetamol, one tablet, 3 times a day. Even though I have not signed anything, because I have said you take, that is a prescription. Okay. If I want the patient to take that paracetamol, but I don't want to get into the problem of having prescribed it, then I will give advice. And what is the advice? I will say that normally, in such circumstances, for patients who have headache and mild fever, if they take paracetamol, one tablet, 3 times a day, 70% benefit from it. Now, I have conveyed the same thing, that tablet, paracetamol, one tablet, 3 times a day. But I have not said you take. Instead of saying you take, I have said that in general, if so many people take, 70% will respond. So this is an example of an advice versus example of a prescription, even though we have not written it down or signed it. And giving an advice is much safer than giving a prescription. If you give a prescription, then anything that happens, they may go to court and complain against us. But if it is just a simple advice, then we have not asked them to take it. We have just said that it might help you, it might not help you. So that is much safer.
Thank you so much, sir.
So while you are going through the list of questions, I will just share with the colleagues that my next webinar is going to be on how to generate a prescription using your smartphone. You don't have to take a printout. You don't have to put a rubber stamp physically, but you can still generate a prescription in such a way that it will comply with all the regulations. And this is also available online. It is available with something that is available, is free to us right now. And therefore, it will help us in providing a document, which is a prescription, which is acceptable at the other side. The pharmacy has to honor it. At the same time, it is convenient for us to generate it and make it available to our people. So that is going to be the discussion in the next webinar.
So we have another question. Yeah. I'll just read them out. I'm unable to mute them. Unmute them, sorry.
Yes.
I will just read it. Can we do telemedicine consultation while sitting in hospital OPD via video call?
So absolutely right. The telemedicine guideline document has clearly stated that the telemedicine consultation can be done from anywhere. If I'm in the airport and doing it on phone, that is possible. If I'm sitting in my clinic, that is possible. If I'm sitting at home, it's possible. If I'm in the car, it is possible. But it has to be convenient to me and I should have easy access. Please understand the document says that the appointment to start the telemedicine consultation has to be given by the doctor. It is in our prerogative. If at 11 o'clock in the night, if a patient calls and says, doctor, I want a telemedicine consultation right now, we can refuse it and the law will support us. So that is very clear. The other thing is that if you are doing the telemedicine consultation, we have to make sure that it is clear and audible and understood by the other party. And therefore, if you are traveling in a car and moving from one cell tower to another cell tower, there's a chance of a call drop, and that is not a good idea. Coming back to the question of can we do it while we are in the hospital doing our duties? Yes, we can do it. It also says that just because I am a government servant, I am in the hospital, I am on duty, does not mean that I have to do a telemedicine consultation. So it has to be done only if you are free and only if we are interested in doing it. If we don't want to do it, nobody can force us to do a telemedicine consultation at any time.
Thank you so much, sir. Now it's the chance of Dr. Dilip to ask his question. Sir, I'm unmuting your mic. So you'll have to unmute your mic. Dr. Dilip, can you hear me? So I'll just read Dr. Dilip's question. Among the free open source software, which one would you recommend for teleconsultation as per the current guidelines?
So it depends on what you want to do with the open source. Okay. So in one of the previous webinars, I had shown a list of 10 open source which are free. And out of them, there was a table that said what is the advantages and disadvantages of each of them. And then the best one, which had 8 green ticks and 2 red crosses, we went and tried to evaluate them. And once I started asking for what is the, how long is it free and will you start charging me, they stopped answering my question. So sometimes I feel that there is no such thing as a free lunch. Every time we find out that something is, advertised as free, it is free for a certain period of time. It is free for a certain amount of utilization, and then it becomes chargeable. But the cheapest one that is on chargeable basis is costs us about 100 rupees per consultation for 15 minutes. And after that, it starts charging at rupees 6 or 7 for every additional minute. This is the cheapest one that I found from the so-called free apps. So it is very difficult to ascertain which is the right one. I think you will have to go through each of them and then decide what is best for you. Sometimes what they promise that they can't deliver, like the consent process that was available online that I explained to you, it does work. It does work to a certain extent, but I did not get a PDF of the consent signed by the patient. So there are some difficulties. And my team is evaluating each of them to the greatest extent possible so that I can share with you really what is the facts and figures behind all these things. I hope that answers your question.
Thank you, sir. Now I'd like to request Dr. Rajiv to ask his question. Sir, I've unmuted him, Mike.
Sir, what should be our fees, sir? I understand you told that fees should not be lesser than what we charge normally, but now that we have to pay 100 rupees to the software guy, yes, and for the platform, etc. So, and we're going to spend 15 minutes or 20 minutes trying to understand. They're not going to be able to understand how to use the mic, how to use the video, all those things.
Yes. Yes.
We're going to waste a lot of time in trying to get them to just sit in front and not move around. So, what should be an average? Because in Bangalore, we charge somewhere around 500, 600 rupees for a regular consultation, oncology consultation. Any super specialty consultation in Bangalore, 600 bucks. So, in Delhi, it was 1,000.
Yes.
So
a face-to-face consultation typically in private lasts for about half an hour. Am I correct?
Sir, correct.
Yeah. So in telemedicine consultation, we should offer a 15-minute slot. Okay.
Okay.
And then if we are charging 600 rupees for 15 minutes as opposed to a face-to-face consultation which lasts for half an hour, it's quite reasonable.
Sir.
The document from the government does not say that you can't charge less or can't charge more. That was okay. my opinion to you, that if you are charging X amount in your in-person consultation, you should not charge less than that. The document only says that your charges have to be reasonable. Now, what is the meaning of reasonable? If you take Ram Jethmalani to your court case in Supreme Court, you will have to pay 1 crore rupees.
Correct.
So, as far as I am concerned, I will share with you clearly what my charges are. I charge 5,000 rupees for a 15-minute consultation.
Okay.
And I say 15 minutes because I don't want them to keep on going for 1 hour, 1.5 hours. However, instead of 15 minutes, if it continues for 20 minutes, I will not stop or I will not ask them to pay again. So it is a discretionary process that we have to follow based on what is the patient. Is he asking genuine questions or is he just irritating you? You can decide whether to stop. But at least if I want to stop after 15 minutes, I have already specified that my consultation with you is 15 minutes. After that, you will have to pay extra. So that is how we have to protect ourselves.
And we probably charge them some small amount for a follow-up. Like if it's a regular patient whom we already been seeing in our practice, rather than them calling up and saying, sir, loose motion ho raha hai, what medicine should I? That's a common thing that all of us face.
Yeah.
So all of those, if we are able to divert.
Absolutely. So my way of dealing with that is that, sir, doctor. Go ahead. Rajiv, we have not, I think we can't hear you, but I will answer your question. What about a follow-up patient? Every time a patient wants to contact me, I say that earlier I was able to guide you and give you advice, but now the government has said that there is a due process to be followed. I cannot just casually guide you because I will be breaking the law. The law requires me to do X, Y, Z and I have to keep a record of everything. Therefore, even if it is a casual question, you will have to take my appointment for a telemedicine consultation and only then I will be able to do that. So I do not provide free follow-up consultation at all. If you want to give a free follow-up consultation at a cheaper price, that is your prerogative. You can even do free as an exception. But you should not make that as a rule. Because now we have to retrain the patient. This is a golden opportunity that the government has given us to retrain our patients. And we put the onus on them saying that we have to now comply with law. The law requires me to do X, Y, and Z. And therefore, I cannot just respond to your WhatsApp question and give you an answer for how to treat diarrhea.
Got it, sir.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Now it is the chance of Dr. Jitender to ask his question. Sir, I have unmuted your mic. Please go ahead, sir. Dr. Jitender, can
you... Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Go ahead.
Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Good evening, sir. Actually, I have one question. If I am exposed to some patient of COVID-19 due to the pandemic and I am in quarantine for that reason, and can I advise chemotherapy for those patients through some medical professional or something like that?
Absolutely, yes. You can do that. Not a problem. Especially because whatever you are doing is from one doctor to another doctor, right? There is a medical personnel at the other
side. Yes, sir. And what?
So that is no problem. Absolutely, you can do. And your risk, medical legal risk is less because the risk is highest with the doctor who is actually giving the treatment under your advice.
Okay. And so what if I am positive for COVID-19 and I am admitted under somebody else's care? So do I need a certificate that I am mentally sound for advice for like that means
no
maybe
need.
Somebody
no need absolutely no problem.
So I can advise.
You can advise, no issues.
Okay, thank you so much.
Absolutely no problem. Rakesh is smiling at the question that was asked just now. Rakesh, would you like to comment on this? A very interesting question. Kavina Creations, you have unmuted Rakesh. Rakesh, you please give your comments now.
Yeah, because I don't think so there are direct neuropsychiatric complications or this of COVID. So I don't think so a person, unless he is that seriously. So I think he is in a state to give a proper legal advice yet. He can give all this.
Perfect. Dr. Rakesh is a very senior psychiatrist and therefore if he is certifying that we are okay.
Yeah, and nice to hear you, Purvesh. It's so nice. I'll join you again next time for the prescription.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Jitendra has raised the hand again. Can we unmute him, please?
Dr. Jitendra, please go ahead. Dr. Jitendra, you'll have to unmute yourself.
You are this, huh?
Jitendra has raised the hand, but he is not unmuted himself. So we can go to somebody else, some other question in the meantime.
So we've got a question and they've requested it to be anonymous. Okay. What is the, I'll read the question. Yeah. What is the eligibility criteria to be a certified teleconsultant?
So anybody who's a allopathic medical doctor is automatically eligible to do telemedicine consultation as of today. From 25th March 2020, from the time that the notification has come into the picture, all of us are certified to do the telemedicine consultation. The only caveat is that we have to get a formal certificate within 3 years. So that means today is 2020, by 2023, 24th March 2023, we should get that. So we have enough time. Unfortunately, what happens is when we get busy, we will start forgetting that we have to do this. So I would suggest that you either open your phone diary and write down that date, that before that date, you must get certified. Or at the end of this, just simply go online and answer the questions. And if you get 35 out of 50 correct, then you are eligible for a certificate, which we will be able to provide to you through Intas.
Thank you so much, sir. We have another question. I will just read the question. Can we prescribe oral targeted agents or chemotherapy on e-consultation?
So absolutely. If the diagnosis of the patient has been confirmed, that is a biopsy, or if you have seen the patient previously in your OPD, and you now want to prescribe oral targeted agents to these patients, you have absolutely no problem in prescribing them. So it is very clear, you can prescribe, no issues.
Thank you so much, sir. We have another question. I will just read out the question. If anything from diagnosis to management goes wrong,
yes,
according to the patient,
yeah,
what is legal risk?
So definitely the onus is on doctors. The document says two things. One is that the telemedicine consultation cannot be inferior to an in-person consultation. Okay. Now, because there are limitations that we can only do inspection on video consultation, we can't do palpation or auscultation. Therefore, we have to be sure that we know what is going on. So the onus is on us. If I feel that I'm confident that I know what is going on and I'm then going to treat the patient fine, then there should not be a problem. If, however, at any time I think that the history is incorrect or whatever reports he is showing me is not consistent with what the disease the patient has, then it is my responsibility to ask for additional investigations, additional reports, additional information. And I should continue with the telemedicine consultation only after that information is available. That does not mean that I cannot prescribe symptomatic treatment in the meantime. So let us say the patient has fever and he is saying that he is bringing out some sputum and it is not in a COVID era. If it was COVID, then suspicion would be for COVID first. But let us assume that it is under normal circumstances. Then I can prescribe paracetamol over the counter list O for his fever. And at the same time, I say that I need you to do a sputum examination. I need you to do an X-ray chest. I need you to do a CT scan. And I can only give you further advice after all these reports reach me. So really speaking, we have to be convinced in our minds that we have a good idea of what is happening to the patient. And because there are some risk, medical legal risk to this, the consent document that I've developed will actually allow you to, you know, protect yourself against many of these risks. So I hope I have answered that question.
Thank you so much, sir. I'm not sure because as we have a username, I will just ask your question. If clinical examination finding missed by local doctor, what is liability of expert giving advice on telemedicine?
So this is also a very important question. It again says that there is a local doctor at the other side. Okay. Now, if the teleconsultation is from me as a specialist and a GP at the other end, I am only giving advice. And I am giving advice to a doctor at the other end. The other end doctor has examined the patient. He knows what is changing in the patient's condition from minute to minute, from time to time. And he has to decide whether my advice is appropriate or not appropriate. So if he follows my advice and treats the patient, or if he doesn't follow my advice and treat the patient, in both instances, the medical legal liability belongs to the GP who's treating the patient, not with me. And therefore, I should be totally safe.
Thank you, sir. We have one more question. I will just ask that. Is telemedicine consultation possible for radiology and pathology?
Right. So this is also, the answer is clear, yes. In fact, teleradiology and telepathology have been going on for several years now. And many of radiologists sitting in India are reporting on X-rays and CT scans and MRIs from United States. They are doing all the donkey's work, and then somebody else who is a board certified radiologist just signs on the report. That has been happening since many years, and so also for pathology. In the document that was brought out by the government of India, it is specifically mentioned that this can definitely be used for telepathology as well as teleradiology. So there should be no doubt in anybody's mind, yes, we can use this for telepathology and teleradiology. No problem at all.
Thank you so much, sir. Can I request Dr. Ankita Sen to ask her question? Ma'am, I've unmuted your mic. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. Yes, I have one more question. Like you said that any RMP can speak to another RMP at the other end.
Yes.
So should the all the rules for telemedicine be maintained in that case also, like maintaining the records of what we whatever advice we are giving to the other practitioner at the other end? Because mostly we would be speaking to our colleagues over the phone and that would be it. So would all the rules apply here? And a second part to that is, should such a situation be always initiated by the other registered practitioner when he is seeking our advice?
So that's a very important question, and I will divide that into two parts. One is this an official request from the other side? And second is this an informal request? So many a times I will phone up my colleague or senior and say, "Yar, I have this difficult case, this and the other. I was thinking of treating like this. What do you think?" This is a indirect informal consultation between me and another doctor, which is not involving the patient. In this instance, it will not fall under telemedicine consultation guidelines, and I should not record this. If, however, a money has to be charged, or I have to write a prescription, or I have to send a letter to the doctor at the other end, then definitely it should be documented, all the records should be kept, and in fact, the patient's consent has to be clearly, explicitly documented that he has requested either me or the other doctor to initiate the process, and he is allowing the two of us to discuss his case.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
I think Dilip has a question.
Yes, Dr. Dilip, I am unmuting your mic. Please go ahead. Dr. Dilip, you'll have to unmute your mic. So I will read Dr. Dilip's question. Can a pathologist claiming NPA from government provide free telepathology consultation under the current rules? NPA is non-practicing allowance.
Correct. So yes, the answer is very clear that a pathologist can provide telepathology consultation. Any doctor can provide a consultation. The consultation need not be charged. You may or may not charge. In a government setup, you may not charge. In a private setup, you may charge. There are several states in India where the government doctors are free to do private practice after 5 p.m. or after 4:30 p.m. when their official time is over. Such doctors can charge even after the official timing is over. As far as NPA is concerned, that is a very important thing. If you are taking non-practicing allowance, then definitely you should not charge. But providing free consultation is a very good thing. It's a noble thing. Currently, there are more than 1,500 doctors who are providing such services for the poor in the rural areas. Many NGOs are working together. And we have Major General Singh, who retired from the army, and he is now head of telemedicine at Rajasthan in Jaipur in the Mahatma Gandhi Hospital. And they are providing more than 100 patients free consultation on a daily basis. So they are doing a noble cause. And if you are wanting to do this free telepathology consultation, Dilip, you are also doing a noble cause. And I would strongly recommend that you continue doing that.
Thank you so much, sir. Please let us know if you have any more questions.
So if there are no more questions, I thank everybody for a wonderful participation. There were very interesting questions. We have a question bank of frequently asked questions also, and we will, after it is edited and curated, we will put that up. So some of the questions that may not have come to you today, but in the future you might have that query, then you can access the FAQs and probably get an appropriate answer from our side. So I thank everybody for participation. It was great to have you guys here. And I hand it over back to the host for continuing with the proceedings and providing the link. Oh, I see that you already provided the link. So wonderful.
So can we take one more question?
Sure, sure.
Dr. Dilip is asking, is there any special software for telepathology?
So that is a great question. We at Icon are using one particular software called Roche Ventana machine. But I'm not sure that I know the details of all the telepathology software that are currently available. There are some more qualified people than me who can give you advice on that. If you send me on the chat, if you send me your email or a WhatsApp phone number, then I will connect you with the right people in teaching hospitals who can guide you on what is the best software for telepathology.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Dr. Parekh, for the wonderful presentation. I would also like to thank all the participants for making the session an interactive one. Before breaking for the night, we'll put the link for the qualifying MCQs for the telemedicine course again, as well as we'll put the telemedicine the content which is there on the Kavina Creations website. We'll put that link. We request you to please copy and paste that, and you can access the link, as well as we'll send the link for the MCQs as well as the telemedicine content to you via email. Thank you, everyone. Once again, on behalf of MedicLogic, Intas, American College of Digital Healthcare, and Kavina Creations, I would like to thank everyone for their participation, and we hope to see you at our next session. Thank you.
And thank you. I've seen the email and WhatsApp number of Dilip, so I will connect with you and connect you to the right telepathology experts. Thank you very much.
So we'll be online for the next 5 minutes. If anyone has any queries, we would be happy to solve them.
So that no part of my body is unnecessarily exposed. So this is, I'm going out, there's a mask, and the mask totally is covering everything. So whatever comes out from my nose and mouth is remaining inside this. No outside atmosphere is going in. I'm trying to reduce as much of the skin exposure as possible. So full sleeve shirt, gloves, full pants and socks, so that no part of my body is unnecessarily exposed. So the bag that I'm taking, and now I'm going for getting the stuff from the groceries. So now I'm back with all the shopping. Fortunately, the grocer provided me this bag, so I didn't have to use my own bag. But whatever bag I'm using, I will not take it into the house. So this is the bag that I took. I'm going to hang it outside. The same thing will also be done that. But now you have to see how I pass on the stuff into the house in such a way that nothing in the house gets contaminated. So the door is opened and the person inside the house does not step out. Okay? They are putting a newspaper outside the house. Now I open this bag and whatever material is there, I put it on the newspaper. So whatever is outside this bag, nobody inside the house actually touches. Now this is put on the newspaper, and now the person who is inside the house will lift the newspaper without touching the contents. And that is taken straight into the kitchen for washing. This procedure is repeated again and again till the entire bag is empty, and then I leave the bag outside so that the bag does not enter into the house. So now my bag is empty and you can lift that piece. He is lifting it carefully without touching the contents. Only he is touching the newspaper. This bag I am leaving outside the house. Now the important thing is, what should I do when I come inside? Okay, I am not touching any of the doors. They will be closed by these people afterwards. If I have to touch anything, it has to be done with the elbow only. Okay, anything that I have contacted outside should not be contaminating any surface in the house. So I come inside here. And the first thing I have to do is to remove the gloves. So, like the typical surgical procedure, I am touching only the outer surface of the gloves with the other gloved hand. Now this is the inner surface of the gloves. And this is my hand. Now I am touching the inside of the gloves and pulling it out. So what you see is, now I am touching only the inner surface of the gloves and not the external side. Once I have done this, next I am going to remove the mask. No doubt. These should be discarded if possible and use fresh ones next time. So because they are to be discarded, I do not bring them into the house. They remain outside and will be disposed of at the next collection of garbage from the house. Okay. Now I have to make sure that the footwear doesn't reach the rest of the house. So I remove the footwear right here. This footwear is also kept outside the house. Okay. So nothing from outside is actually going to enter. Now what I do is to remove the socks before walking into the bathroom. The first thing I have to do is now go to the bathroom and have a shower. Wash my hands with soap and water, followed by a shower. And all the clothes that you are seeing, I am wearing, will be immediately put separately for washing in the washing machine. If you have a washing machine, the temperature is sufficient to get rid of the virus. If you don't have a washing machine, still you must soak them and wash them separately. If you take these precautions, then nothing from outside is going to enter the house, and hopefully you will be safe through the pandemic. Now somebody else from the house will come and close the door so that I don't have to touch anything with potentially contaminated hands.
Dr. Nagender, we have noted your question and I will pass that to Dr. Parekh. Thank you, everyone. I will now end the meeting. Thank you so much.